Diana Tamblyn is a Joe Schuster and Ignatz nominated cartoonist who has been actively writing and drawing comics for over 14 years. She's exhibited her comics at small press fairs and comic book shows in both Canada and the US, and has had artwork displayed in various group and solo shows. In 2005, she was chosen for the Globe and Mail as a Canadian cartoonist to watch. Her latest comic project is From Earth to Babylon, the story of Gerald Bowl and the Supergun. This is a historical-based work on the life of Canadian Gerald Bowl, considered to be one of the most brilliant artillery scientists of the 20th century. Diana, as I mentioned, is also the creator of our Ting Graphic and Comic Arts Festival. Our first speaker is Mariko Tamaki, who is an award-winning artist and writer across a range of genres, including theater, fiction, and nonfiction, as well as graphic novels, and that's, of course, just a snapshot of the creativity that she has in her past. She has garnered much acclaim for both her written and performance-based work. Her graphic novel, Skim, created with her cousin, Jillian Tamaki, was shortlisted for the Governor General's Award and received numerous accolades, including the Doug Wright Award for Best Graphic Novel, the Ignatz Award, and the Joe Schuster Award. She teamed up with her cousin, Jillian, again to produce the award-winning graphic novel This One Summer. Just this year, she has announced that she is going to be working on a new Hulk series starring Jennifer Walters for Marvel Comics and the miniseries Supergirl for DC Comics. She recently published her young adult book, Saving Montgomery Sole. Teva Harrison is the author of the best-selling and critically acclaimed graphic memoir, In Between Days, published by House of Anansi Press. The book was listed in the Globe's 16 Canadian Reads for the first half of 2016, the CBC's Spring Book Preview, and 49th Shelf's Most Anticipated, our Spring 2016 Nonfiction Preview. She's in love with the natural world and fascinated by the spaces between people, places, and ideas, and the way technology is changing our relationships. Her works are freeform, freeform exploration of evolving ideas. Teva's comics explore everything from her magic-filled hippie childhood to what it means to live with metastatic breast cancer. Her comics have appeared regularly in the Walrus's website. I'm going to turn it over to Deanna. Join me in welcoming our group.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks for coming out this afternoon. Mariko and Teva are great speakers and storytellers, as you may know from their many appearances on various CBC and radio programs. And I'm sure we're going to get some good stories from them again today. So I've got some questions for you both and some questions for you individually. And feel free to chime in as you see fit. So we're going to start off with a question for both of you. Mariko, you are Canadian.
Yes.
But you've lived in Toronto, you've lived in Montreal, but you now live in California.
Yes.
And Teva, you're American, and you now live in Toronto.
Yes.
Lovely and powerful thing.
Great answers coming so far. But I wanted to ask you how does living in another country now affect your work?
I think as an artist, a sense of place necessarily informs one's work because what we're reacting to, at least for me, what I'm reacting to is what's around me, what I'm exposed to on a regular basis. The feeling of a place comes out of my work, even though what I'm drawing about my childhood, it has a different feel than what I'm drawing about my current life. It's always rooted in that sense of where I was physically, where I am emotionally, where I am mentally. I can't separate those discreetly, but they absolutely deeply inform my work.
I don't think I've ever been more Canadian than I have been since moving to the United States. I think it's because when you move to the States, you become like the Canadian. Like it becomes a salient feature of who you are. And it makes you really think about the things about yourself that are, for example, Canadian. I've always been like a very proud Canadian, and I have been more so since living in California. I also think that nostalgia is a really powerful thing, and I'm someone who writes about children and younger people a lot, so that definitely influences, like, it makes me, I think, more about my childhood, more about my poor childhood in places like Northern Ontario and the cottage and stuff like that. And I really appreciate, like, take it in much more. It kind of makes you like a tourist in your own past, and you're like, oh, look at this corner store, this is so amazing, like, just, it's kind of annoying. But I also think that at the same time, I mean, when I was doing, I did like 2 years, and only 2 years, of a PhD in anthropology at U of T, and the whole notion there was the way to really study a place is to be an outsider in it. And I always thought that was really, and that was really bogus. And that was just an excuse to go to other places and like plunder their histories for your own benefit. Not to disagree with all this respect. But I think what I have noticed, despite the fact that I thought that was wrong, was that I do also notice things that I think, you know, I notice differences, which makes me notice things about, for example, there's a high school that's across the street from me in Oakland. And I'm always spying on those kids, and I'm fascinated by all the things that seem to have changed about being a teenager, and I think sort of taking an interest in that, which is sort of what you do as an outsider looking in, is you know, is beneficial to you as a writer.
Can I join in really quickly?
Of course.
I know it's not fast, but you mentioned childhood in nature and how you live in a city, although I followed a reverse trade path. That is also really key because I grew up in the middle of nowhere. We had a hitchhiking post outside of our general store. and now I live in the middle of the city. And I think for me, that difference, that urban to rural, rural to urban sort of transition, is more of a difference in terms of my experience and sense of place than Canada to America.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think even just like the way people talk to you in every city, like you go to a smaller town, you're not in the city, and people are like, hi, and you're like, am I talking to you? And like, I think that's actually a big thing. Yeah, I mean, I live in a place where it's like a small town inside of a big town or a big city, and I'm constantly amazed by the number of people who make eye contact when it feels not appropriate. Makes me an aggressive person.
Talk a little bit about your genesis as a writer and creators. So here's a selection of Mariko is very prolific, as you can see. This is not even all of her works here. You started off as a writer of prose,
yes.
And then the first time I heard of you was the single comic Skim, which turned into a graphic novel. But I saw this at TCAP in 2005.
Yeah.
And when I saw it, it seriously knocked me out. It's like, who are these people? And this is the best comic. But how did that comic come about?
I was living in Toronto, and I was, so I had been a writer for a long time, and I had mostly done, I did a short novellas cover me, like when I was 20, which someone just bought, which was amazing to me. And then I had been kind of like a cabaret performer. So I did a lot of sort of short pieces going up on like feminist lesbian stages where you like talk about your relationships and how people hurt your feelings, but in like a prose form, which makes it hard, amazingly. So I had done a lot of that. I had done a lot of like just sort of transcribing my past into like a piece that I could read on a microphone. And then I had kind of given it up a little bit. Like, I had sort of thought, like, well, this is really not going anywhere. Like, I'm sort of, wasn't really moving forward. It wasn't really sort of, for whatever reason, it just wasn't going anywhere. And so I sort of moved on to doing a master's in women's studies, which I recommend everybody go to. Yeah, because they're amazing. And then I knew this woman, Emily Polgary, who's this incredible writer and also just someone who's always, she's done an incredible amount for Canadian women especially in creating places for women to publish and perform their work. And so she had started this magazine called Kiss Machine, which was a literary magazine in Toronto, and it was really an incredible place where, unlike sort of other literary magazines, it was entirely possible to get your work published there. It wasn't a big, like, it wasn't a big, you know, ivory tower around it. It was super accessible. And she decided, because she got into comics, that she was going to create a mini series of comics for women creators, for women writers and women illustrators to work together. Which is just like, the idea that would happen is so insane. Like, when does that happen? Someone's just like, are you a feminist and a woman? Why don't you make a book and I'll pay you to do it? But it never happens. And I was on tour with her, and I knew that Jillian, my cousin, was sort of coming into her own as an illustrator, and I just knew she was incredibly talented. And she was really the only, you know, person that I thought that I could do this with. And so I just called her and was like, I really want to do this. Will you please do this with me? And she was just really nice and agreed to do it, basically. And the good thing was that, I mean, as an opportunity, which is why it's so important that arts councils and stuff like that support these things, because it was an opportunity to do something that wasn't a huge pressure situation. It didn't have to be a bestseller. It was just a chance to experiment, to try something. It was a chance for a writer who'd never written comics to work with somebody and try to make a comic. And really, it just, like, it just worked. Like, for whatever reason, it just really resonated. I think because there was no pressure, because we weren't doing it to anything, it just ended up being this thing that really spoke to people. And from that, just everything spiraled. Like, from that, we just basically got all of these opportunities. We got a lot of support from the comics community in Toronto, and we got like a little, like a mini award from the Doug Wright Award, like when they used to be held at like a bar in Toronto. And then from that, we got a publisher, and it just kind of exploded from there.
The Doug Wright Awards had to create a special award just for Skim because they thought it was excellent and it didn't fit into their categories, but they're like, we have to give them something.
Yeah, and I think that is, you know, just quickly, like, I think that there is something about being an artist, my experience of being an artist in Toronto, which is not to say the overall experience of being a Canadian artist, but I always had the sense that there was a place and support for the thing that I was trying to do. Even if it was, like, a literary series that was getting, like, a little bit of money to sort of, you know, pay artists and put on things in a stage where you could get, like, you know, a couple people to come and see you, and, you know, a little bit of money to tour or whatever. Like, there was just always a place for whatever I wanted to do, and I'm eternally grateful for that.
This is just some of the panels from Skim that you're looking at right now that turned into a full-length graphic novel. One of the things I love about Skim and Jillian and Rico's work is that, as you can see, these are real people. They're not a glamorized picture of what people look like, which you usually see in comic books. And so refreshing. So, which is similar for Teva. We're going to move to Teva here.
Boom.
So, Teva, you do not have a background in comic books. And a few years ago, you were diagnosed with stage 4 metastatic breast cancer. And apparently, that's when you started drawing. And you were drawing, and then the drawings kind of turned into comic books. And can you talk a little bit about the process of why drawing and what that meant for you and the process?
Absolutely, of course. I don't have a background in comics, but I do have a background in art. I have always been an artist since I was small. My mom was an artist, so a single parent household, not always in that attention, but always in that art class. and I studied art in school, I studied painting and drawing, and then I worked as one does because I know I was a working artist for a little while, but it was hard to live. Even though the arrival at the time in Washington was cheap, it was still a challenge to make my transition to being out of paying bills. So I started doing arts administration, and then I shifted into my ran a film festival for a while, other kinds of arts festivals. And I moved to Canada, and I was working for the Nature Conservancy of Canada as the director of marketing when I was diagnosed. So I had a job that was creative, in theory, but in experience, you spend a lot of time on budgets and strategic plans and brand identity and all kinds of things that are crucially important, but not necessarily personally artistically fulfilling. And when I was diagnosed, I slipped into the deepest, darkest depression because I was diagnosed directly at stage four. I didn't move my way up as the majority of people do. I already had cancer in my bones when we found the primary tumor in my breast. So I was really lost. It was this major disruption in my life. I couldn't work. Really, physically I couldn't at the time, but I was just sitting in my office crying and things bad. So I went on leave and I was at home and I was talking to a psychiatrist trying to figure out how to move forward, how to deal with the feelings I was having. And I was going home and I was drawing as a way not to roommate. One of the first things we did, my mom came to visit, she wanted to do something to help. And she and my husband cleaned up my basement and turned it into my studio for me because I have tumors in my spine, so I'm not really allowed to move furniture. So I had this place to go, and it was full of all the ephemera of my life, the little things I held on to. As we found them, we've been tacking them to the wall. So I was surrounded by all of these memories. And I was drawing and I was talking, and the conversations with my psychiatrist were digging down into the feelings, not the actuality of the disease, but the feelings, which were really analogous to the worst feelings in my life. So I was remembering my worst experiences, and I was drawing them. I just started, it was not a conscious choice. I was drawing because I was drawing not to think. And out of those drawings came these little one-page comics, initially about the worst things in my life, but then because I was thinking about childhood, I was surrounded by all this ephemera of a life lived, I started to remember the best parts of my childhood. I started to remember these little snippets of joy, like having a summer snowball fight with my best friend by ripping the flowers off his mom's bush. And I started drawing those sorts of things. And through that process, drawing was lifting me up. That was a language that was really accessible to me because where I was sitting was just how things started coming out. So when I finally got to a place where I was willing to talk about the fact that I had cancer and trying to unpack some of my feelings around it, it just came out in that form. And it's been helpful too, because it sort of functioned as a way of taking this dive into the dark, much like the mermaid on the cover, back up into the light, joyous experiences that are analogous to a good part of my childhood too. It's really powerful stuff, experientially.
And my understanding is you did some of these one-page cartoons. Your friends encouraged you to put them online.
Oh yeah, sorry, I can tell you that. Yeah, I hadn't shown them to anybody. I hadn't even told Facebook that I had cancer. I was almost a year in. I was holding it pretty close to the people I was closest to, but I had a couple friends who had, still have, because that's how it goes with stage 4 cancer, metastatic breast cancer from my age, and they both independently had the same reaction of, these could help people. And so I thought about that. I thought, if these could be helpful to other people who are feeling alone with these same sorts of feelings that I'm having, then that's worth getting over myself and putting it out there. So I chatted with actually a mutual friend in Toronto about, what would you do? And he said, put them online. Then whoever needs them will find them. And I did that, and a month later I got an email from the online editor at The Walrus saying, would you be interested in migrating your comics to our website where they'll have a good audience? And I said, of course, clearly. And a month later I got an email from my publisher saying, I think you have the beginning of the book here if you want to. Do you want to come and talk? So it was a very unusual and magical process for me in that regard too. At that first meeting, she had seen my publisher, my editor, had seen my blog where I'd been posting one comic along with a little short vignette, and before they went to the Walrus website, and they were interested in that idea of the sort of blog plus a hybrid. So from that first meeting to holding the book, it was less come here.
And it's important to say that Teva's book, In Between Days, has been nominated for a Governor General's Award for nonfiction, which is the first graphic novel that's ever received such a nomination.
Oh, cool.
That brings us to talking about collaboration and support. So my mom, who's sitting in the audience there, has talked about, you know, in the Renaissance, we have patrons, which enable people to do their artwork. My mom says now that patrons are partners, spouses, and without them, they enable us to do what we do. And so I know each of you has family support, friend support, but also you both have partners, I think, are really important to your creative process. And I want you to talk a little about that, kind of give them some props about what that means to you in your artwork.
I mean, it really is this notion that it's a solitary thing, like the actual part, there's a part of it that's just like you in a coffee shop or wherever it is you can afford to go, working. But I mean, I've always been, and I said this like a couple days ago, I've always been a huge fan of collaboration. And I'm infinitely grateful that I have, first of all, that I get to make comics with other people. And I have always just, like, it really is like, I think you have to admire the people that you work with. And I have endless admiration for Jillian, as well as the other people that I've worked with, and I've got to work with really amazing people over the years. And they're all different. Like, you know, I feel like it depends on the culture too. And that is the other thing, like, I feel like my publisher, like, I feel like publishers have to believe in the books that they're putting out. And we have Grapnic Books, which was a really amazing place to have. Our first publisher for Skim, and was our Canadian publisher for this one summer. And then we've been working with her second, who's just an incredible publisher, and who we had Calista Brown and Mark Siegel, who've been incredible to work with. So yeah, and then, you know, I mean, obviously, like, there's another side of it too, which is like your agent, like my agent, Charlotte, she is the best. I love her so much. She's so amazing. And it's just like all these people who believe in your work and support you and are there to sort of get you through to the place where you need to go, which is really so much of writing is like, not just writing the script, but like, and getting the final product, but like then working with someone to get it where it needs to go, which is a huge part of it. And yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I have an amazing girlfriend, Heather Cole, and it is such a challenge to work with, to live with a writer. Like, we're just not fun people. We're just like, we seem fun now. I'm not fun. Because you are, like, there is this thing of like, you're in this world that is entirely imaginary and a product of your own brain. And it's really hard to be something outside of that. Like, on one hand, you need someone to believe in you and believe in the work that you're doing. And on the other hand, you need somebody who is like whole loving person outside of that. And it really is, I'm eternally grateful that I have that. And I also have parents who basically gave me money for many, many years while I was like, I'm not gonna have a job so much. You have great books. And then you'll give me money so that I can do that. Actually, like, on every book, almost ever written has some acknowledgments to my parents for their patronage. Because they gave me money for a very long time when I was writing books. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for watching this video. I appreciate it.
I'm going to start in the other direction with my husband. I have always been, you know, I've been married for, we've been together for 15 years and married pretty much the whole time. And as an artist, I appreciate his support, but it's a whole different level when you're also living with a terminal disease. I need support in ways that he didn't know he was signing up for, you know? And having someone who's really solid who you can lean on for everything from making you breakfast when you just have radiation and you can't go upstairs and making sure you eat it, you know, to reading everything I write first, he's my first reader of everything. he's an excellent communicator and makes things better. He's so supportive. He can talk me down from the downward spiral. I don't know how to accomplish things without that gentle support he gives me. And it is collaboration, because he is my first reader, always. And he brings something, because he knows me, that is different to what the other people I collaborate brings, because he brings the knowledge of what I'm going to obsess about later, not just what makes the book better.
Right.
Yeah. But also with this book, both my editor and my designer were so crucial in making it better. It's such a, I was talking to them about how unfair it is that there's just one name here on the spine, because yes, I did the drawing, yes, I did the writing, but like you were saying the first night, it's better for their touch. It's I come from a fine art background, not an illustration background, so I've been learning this craft as I go with this project. I first showed up at the Walrus when I had been invited to bring my drawings in with these little fuzzy sketches with just a little marker on a small page. And then the next day I went into the office, their art director had gone with the editor who invited me and another member of their staff. The art supply store bought me everything that they thought I needed to go up a level, to like, and then their art director gave me this detailed description of what everything he gave me was, from like illustration board, why what weight, why what color, what white block is, what different, gave me different nibs and brush pens and all kinds of things. And that allowed me to accelerate the progress of my craft infinitely. And then even he'd sit down with me as I turn things in and explain process. So it's been fascinating education, and people are so generous. People are so excited. I've promoted a lot of other people's art over the year, but the feeling when you have other people lifting you up, believing in you, and wanting to help you be better is beautiful. It's almost hard to take in the beginning, but it's a gift.
Well, that's the point too, is I think, I mean, one thing is that, like, the fact that my girlfriend is an artist, I think also, and because I think that being around and being in a community of artists, which for me starts in my house, where we like, everything is like, everything we talk about is a deliberation about the artistic merit of a thing. Like, we're like sitting at lunch, like, you know, dissecting whatever it is, and that's like, so you're always surrounded by it, but I think it's also really crucial to have a community of artists around you who, A, are giving you the knowledge. You know, it's like my for example, like my girlfriend is a performer and is a writer, but also does theater and all kinds of other sort of spoken art forms. And I learn from her every time. Like, I learn from her, and I think that also, like, I have this amazing community of people who know so much more about comics than I do, and are always sort of telling me what to read and that. And, you know, I get from that as well, and it really is like this constant thing. I can't imagine living in a world where you're surrounded by accountants and you're like, I'm gonna go make some literary stuff now, see you later, and then you just go off and do your stuff. I think being in a community is so crucial.
Yeah, absolutely. And to what you just referenced, having a community of people, because I've always enjoyed comics, but I don't come from a comic background, so my knowledge coming into this project was pretty thin, and having a community of people like Peter, again, to support my emerging literacy has been a real gift, because then I can also go and say, I'm interested in how different people break a page. And whoever's in the store will pull down all these things that they're doing in Toronto. It's highly recommended. but people are excited to share what they're passionate about. So you have these really high-level, positive, creative conversations with people that are really nourishing.
Right, and that's the positive part of being a nerd. Like, I think sometimes we get into like the negative part of being a nerd, which is like, there's a kind of nerddom that's like the, let me tell you all the things I know that you don't know. And the better part of nerddom is like this real like joy of sharing. Like, oh my god, you're gonna love this thing. Like, I think that that's like my favorite part. It's not just like I hate these comics, I love these comics, and that's right because I've done all this research and you haven't, but more like, you have got to read, you know, it's like when, you know, every time I go to a convention, like some of the people when I was talking about Supergirl comics, and this was obviously before I was writing, where I hadn't really fell in love with Supergirl comic in a long time, and this guy was like, I've been talking about Chris Ware, and he was like, oh, you have to read Hawkeye, because Hawkeye's amazing. And I was like, okay, you know, like, also just accepting that whatever you think you know about a medium or about any kind of written form is only what you know, and there's always space to, like, grow from that.
This brings us nicely in our mutual love about collaboration and partnership.
Adam, please, teacher. Yes. I'm going to talk a little bit about the combination of words and images in comics. And we've got two people. So Mariko does prose novels. She writes for comics. Teva's In Between Days. It's not just a graphic novel, so she's got one page that's one page comic, and then it's opposite one page of prose. And so it's an interesting kind of dynamic. And the reason why I have the picture here of Jillian and Mariko is because they've worked together a few times. Jillian's the illustrator, Mariko's the artist, and they've been nominated for lots of different awards together. But people are very confused as to the creation of comic process. So Mariko has been nominated for Skim, and they didn't nominate Jillian.
Right.
Jillian was nominated for This One Summer. They didn't nominate Mariko.
Oh, I did get nominated, but I didn't win. She won, I didn't win.
So it's fine. They're obviously a duo,
right.
And they're a proud Canadian duo.
And
yeah. And I've got a page here from This One Summer, which is two words on it. So this doesn't mean that there's not writing involved in the rest of the panels, which people, I think, are confused about.
Well, I think the thing is that, I mean, I'm not sure where exactly the division comes from. I think it probably comes from more of a children's book place where you can have this like kind of parallel narrative, so like where also it sort of seems like the division between text and images maybe is more obviously separate. That's a guess. Don't quote me on that. Or taking this, but I think it was, you know, it was such an incredibly horrible experience to have this moment where it felt like the book was being lauded in this way that felt like it was excluding this thing that was so important. And it's been this kind of long journey of getting to a place where there is this greater understanding of that it's a story that's being told by two people. It's not even where the words and the, you know, like the idea, it's not quantitative. Like I know there's this famous Debbie Travis quote about what makes a comic more or less literary, and she said, I guess, that Jekyll Myers' Essex County series could be literary because there weren't enough words in it. Thanks, Debbie. but
that
really,
was one of Canada Reads. Debbie was a jury member on Canada Reads, and Doug Wright Award, Essex County was on it. And
right.
It was discounted right away from Debbie Travis because it couldn't be a literary book because there's not enough words.
Right.
And I think it's a big controversy.
Huge controversy. I, to this day, think Debbie Travis is poison. Despite anything I've learned from her in the past, it's all totally gone now because of that. But I think it just really is a fundamental misunderstanding of like that it's a story. It's not about this idea of like there's two words on the page and there's a bigger illustration or any of those things. It's that it really is the combination of two people telling a story together. And I don't think of it as, you know, anybody, like someone says, sometimes people talk about someone illustrating your story. It's not really not that. It's that one person in a, you know, in combination of people comes up with the notion of what the story will be, and sort of lays, you know, the groundwork of who the characters are and all of that, you know, where it is and stuff like that. But really, there's this incredible, hard to tack down moment where it becomes a story that you're telling together, where someone gives a body and a shape to the characters, gives them movement, gives them expression, gives, you know, tone and light and darkness to the page and all of those things which contribute to the story that you're reading. And I mean, I've also had people come up to me and say both that they just read the words in a comic or that they only look at the pictures. John, like, well, you paid for the whole book, so that's your choice. But it is this kind of, I think too, it's this kind of organic tradition we have of the author that people kind of want to maintain. And I think that literary works really kind of laud is this idea of the, you know, one person's creative vision, which is a shame because if you think of so many of the, you know, so many mediums we work in, like film and television and theater, where it really is a combination of people that make something happen. And yeah, I know that they changed the rules after the year that this one summer won, the Governor General. And it was funny because I was just so proud of the book. And I'm really happy to think that going forward that it will be that a book gets judged as a book and not as, you know, who did what in any given moment.
And Teva, I wanted you to touch on a little bit the use of prose and cartoons. I mean, I didn't realize that it was because you had blog posts that accompanied your cartoons, but I find it works really nicely in the book.
Yeah, I think it gives you room to breathe because the comics are like little bombs. They're little like cherry bombs, and they're fast and they're hard and they're over. And I think having the prose in between gives a little bit of space for people to and breathe before moving on to the next one. It's interesting though, can I touch on the other thing too? Awesome. When I'm writing, I get the idea down. I'm not writing for words or pictures when I'm writing. I just have the idea and I scribble down what the idea is, but then I strip away everything that I think I can tell with pictures, and tell with pictures, and then what's left, what I need words for, you know, that it's that bare process. And I was talking to a friend of mine who's a poet, and she was asking me what my process is like. And when I describe that dump, strip, refine, dump, then I read it out loud to see where the natural breaks are, where you breathe, and that's where we move from one thing to the next. I think we have this tendency to try to put things in one space as this is this craft, this is another craft, where the act of creation is by sculpture too. You're carving out a world in space that's in your head and you just have to get it down. And in my process, I don't really have hierarchy between word and image. Instead, together, they create something that is greater than a part. I occasionally call the contribution of a book about images, and I really prefer not to because I think it doesn't feel the same when you're creating something to have a different sort of sensory input. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting. I think that because there's prose, the book is easier for a lot of people who are still a little hesitant around comic form to come into.
You mentioned your background in marketing, and I have to say that Teva is an incredibly organized artist. She's sent me like a zip file with 50 images in it, which are crisp and clean. Nobody does that. First time ever. So I read a quote in one of your interviews about what your career in marketing taught you in terms of artwork. And you said, it's a minimalist approach. And when you're talking about refining and taking away things until you have the essence of something, right? And that
really just like making an ad.
Actually.
It is.
Yeah.
And it really comes across in your book, I think. The drawings are minimalist, but they're really raw and really powerful and very evocative. I was talking to somebody yesterday who said he's had to kind of take breaks in reading your book because it's so powerful, so he's got to put it down, pick it up, put it down.
That's not uncommon. It's not uncommon. Every once in a while, someone will say, I just read the whole thing in an afternoon, but I also get quite a few people saying, I just take the bites, and that's enough, which I think is also like poetry. So,
Sorry, not to.
No, it's true. But go on. So it's true. And in terms of the subject matter, and we're talking about compartmentalizing things and what is writing, what is drawing, what is a graphic novel, what is a book, what is a children's book, and I bet you people, booksellers, are having a hard time figuring out where to put the book tables. Is it in nonfiction? Is it in graphic novels? Is it in, sometimes they go to the kids section for graphic novels and I pull books out of there and that is not for kids. Just because it has pictures in it, that's not the kids. And then put it in the graphic novels adult section.
I've been interested
to see where it shelves different places. I go in and look and say, where is it going to be here? Is it going to be in health? Is it going to be in graphic? Is it? It really varies. Booksellers put it where it makes sense for them.
Exactly. And in terms of the subject matter, which could be as interesting, we say, the prose parts you thought of to give people a break between the cartoons, which are very powerful. With kind of a very, simple line drawings. That you said the book is not about dying of cancer, it's a book about living with cancer. How to live with joy, how to live with possibility.
Cancer, or really I think any terminal diagnosis, is very limiting initially. And living in an ongoing way, but living is not. And once you get through the shock of a thing, you have to figure out how to go on. Because even though the median survival of metastatic breast cancer is 2 to 3 years, there are some women who live decades. And science is moving so rapidly. I'm on a clinical trial myself, and I'm pretty much stable, and I've been on it for nearly 2 years, which is great with treatments for metastatic breast cancer. You often don't even get a full year out of them if they work well. You have no idea what will work. It would take a really high amount of uncertainty. So you have to approach life a little bit differently, right? You have to find joy now. Find ways to enjoy what this moment is giving. Really, it's clarified me. It's pared down how I want to spend my time, who I want to be with. What's important? What's important is, even with the people I love, it's creating as much as I can while I'm here. It's having delicious food and spending time in my garden and laughing. And it's so easy to go down a dark hole when you're essentially told you're going to die. You know, I don't have a scale of faith. My day, and I don't really want one. I have found that it has amplified the beauty in life, and that is a really important distinction for me with the book, because it is about cancer, it is about living with this very significant thing that will never change in my life, but it's about living, it's about breathing into it, and finding my forward.
That's very well said. I wanted to talk a little bit about each of you have new things coming out. So Mariko has a young adult book out right now called Saving Montgomery Sole, which is an amazing book. You have worked for DC Comics before on the Minx line. I think on a really underrated title of Emiko Superstar. And Mariko is going to be working for both the big two, DC and Marvel Comics. For DC, she's going to be doing a Supergirl series. And for Marvel, she's going to be doing Hulk, which is starring She-Hulk, which both members of my family are very excited about. We have very different people who are excited to meet me now. Seems my like the people who come up want to shake my hand. It's very different group of people now. So talk a bit about the differences about working in prose, literary, Canadian fiction, and indie comics, and part of DC.
Well, it's really interesting. Actually, it's a very different challenge to write. Most of the challenge is to write a character that exists already outside of you. Like, it's really about taking something that, you know, is out there, like especially someone like Supergirl, who's already very iconic, and then trying to make a story that's your own, but that is still very true to the, you know, the origin story that you're being given. And I have found it a really interesting puzzle. I actually started my first comic that I did was I did a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, I did Casey April. So I started there. And it was really just like it's challenging to use characters that aren't yours. It's also challenging to work in a format which is like somewhere between 20 and 22 pages. Like, it actually is incredibly different from graphic novels in that you only have 22 pages, and so you actually have to write to the page, which I never do in graphic novels. I'm actually working on a comic for First Second with Rosemary Lero O'Connell called Where He Keeps Breaking Up With Me. And it's so fun to write graphic novels because you're like, whatever, I don't know how long it's going to be. Here you go. Have fun. It's going to be amazing. It's really long. It's probably really long. Like, you just sort of hand it over. But it's been just a really incredible challenge to try to figure out how to shape an arc in six issues with like a limited amount of space. I really love the publishers that I've been working with. It's been a real actual joy to work with both Marvel and DC. And I'm not just saying that because it's entertaining. but no, it really has. And in both cases, with Supergirl, I've been paired up with Joel Jones, who's just incredible. And the artwork that I've seen the first issue, and it's so good. It's like giving me the chills whenever I read it because it's so beautiful. And then when I got to work on Hulk, when I first told you who I'd be working with, and it's Nico Leung, who is like the funniest, smartest illustrator. And he and I have these hysterical conversations where he thinks of all of the stuff that I wouldn't have thought of. Like, I will say, when you read this comic, there'll be so much stuff for you to notice in the illustrations that is not necessarily going to be like immediately referenced in the text. Like, it really is just chock full of all these incredible details that he has thought of. Yes. So it's just like, it's a really fun job. Like, it's just an incredibly, weirdly amazing thing that I just get to sit down and think, like, what's she all doing today? You know, what's going on with her? And then just like listen to Nine Inch Nails on it right away. So yeah, and then, you know, I think it's funny because I do think of it as a very literary thing. Like, there's times when it feels like it's a struggle to be literary because there's so much you have to do. Like, exposition is not a very literary thing, and exposition is a pretty essential part of a lot of sort of trade comic work, because you have to explain what's happening because you don't have a lot of space and time. But it's like a challenge to keep it literary. And I've been really impressed by reading some of the comics that have come up recently. Like, there's a lot of amazing people, like Jillian Tamaki and Hope Larson and all these other super cool Brandon Fletcher. All these super cool people who are writing in comics that I really like their work.
Yeah.
And that's kind of
why we're just searching into it. Like, we're saying, hey.
Yeah, so I didn't do much. much besides work on it between days when I was working on it. I was very early into my diagnosis when we had that conversation. I was in my first year, and I didn't yet know that I was going to be doing as well as I am right now. So when they gave me a timeline, I balked because they said, oh, it takes about 2-3 years to make a book, and I said, that might be what I have. Clearly, I'm still here. But they said, well, we can do it in less if you can. And so that meant I had to work hard. And I have some physical limitations, so really all I could do is the drugs I take. My hands hurt. So I can only draw 70 hours a day. So all I was doing was drawing about cancer. I was pale. My sister came to visit. She was like, David, how's your history? And he was like, no, she just hasn't been in the sun. and so when I finished, I wanted to spend some time just doing things that delighted me. And I had taken, and I think this was really key to my creating it between days. I had taken a mindfulness-based cognitive therapy class at Princess Margaret Cancer Center with other cancer patients. And it combines mindfulness-based cognitive therapy with mindfulness-based meditation with cognitive behavioral therapy. And that experience of building up a meditation practice while building my art practice back up was so interlinked. And I became really interested in this idea because I was talking to a lot of mindfulness people about how coloring makes mindfulness accessible to people who don't even need to know they're doing it. It provides this space and calm in people's lives, not just, I see people in waiting rooms coloring all the time, and it helps manage anxiety, it helps people calm down after a day of work. So there's this really beautiful way that coloring is helping people, whether they call themselves people who meditate or not. So I like the idea of tapping into that. But I also, it was funny, actually, it came out of misunderstanding. I wanted to make a coloring book, but I was in a lot of room with my my editor, and she said, Sarah, I want you to make a book. And I said, a coloring book? And she said, I said a cookbook. So that might happen, but not just yet. I really wanted to draw and then put it out in the world and see what other people did with it. I like this idea of a big scale collaborative project with anybody who wants to participate. I'm going to build a page on my website and ask people, so if you do pick up a coloring book, send me pictures of your drawings because I'm going to put a page up because I think it's important for people to know how accessible it is. People say, oh, no, I'm not good at coloring. Please, how can you not be good at coloring? Just have fun. Put color down. Why isn't it just a suggestion? So when we agreed, when I sat down and she said, actually, we do want to do your coloring book. I was like, really? You want my literary publisher wants to make my coloring book? They did make one with Charlie Pachter in 1975, so that is the second one they've ever made. But they just gave me carte blanche. I said, I want to just draw things that make me happy while I'm buying them, while I'm looking at them. So they range from dinosaurs eating cake while volcanoes explode to African animals or Arctic flowers or, like a dance party or mandalas. I can't express how much joy went into this book, and I hope it's matched with what comes out of it. And the paper is ridiculously beautiful. You can use markers. I wanted that to be an option. It feels like heaven.
Love good paper.
Yeah.
I freak out about paper.
Cool wellness notebooks. Best paper. Oh my God, I so love them. So on that note of collaboration and partnership, we will wrap up our discussion. And I think Josh, I want to thank you very much, you two, for coming.
Thank you for being amazing.